Welcome to the future, where the glass is half full and you'll need new glasses, where you'll be jumping from conclusions.
The past is null, and a new future is born.
Never before in history has so much meant so little to so many. AD on the radio.
You know, if you are like everybody else that listens to this show, there's a very good chance you asked me this one specific question today. I've been inundated with this question on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, email. Every way it's possible to contact me, people have contacted me and asked me this question. This question is an interesting one. How long have we been on the air now? What, a little over 4 years. We're not some old school heritage show that's been on since your grandpappy's day or anything like that, but we've been on for some time now. And well, that makes this significant because this has to be the question I've been asked the most since starting here. Yeah, since this show began a little over 4 years ago, this is a question that I've been asked more than any other question. And it's all come over the last 24 hours. And that question is, by the way, if you're wondering if we were still living in the year 2018 where everything is freaking nuts, the answer is yes, because the question I've been asked more than anything else since I started this show, and the question I've been asked constantly in the last 24 hours was this: do you think Vladimir Putin bugged President Trump's new World Cup soccer ball? I mean, it has been absolutely crazy town ever since Vladimir Putin and Donald J. met at the Helsinki summit. And, you know, you can sort of understand why. There's the big question that people have been asking left, right, and center of, hold on, did he just say he buys Vladimir Putin's explanation of meddling in our election over his own intelligence operatives? What does that say? Where do his loyalties lie? Well, of course he's going to say that he believes Vladimir Putin over the people that say there was Russian interference in the election. If Vladimir Putin says there was no interference, that means he couldn't have been colluding. So he gets off the hook with that particular narrative. And, well, obviously it didn't work, but I think that was the intention. He's walking that one back a little bit now, but that obviously set the cat amongst the pigeons literally all over the world. I checked in on this English talk radio show the other day, a guy called James Max, who's on talk radio in London. And he was like, so your president, do you think he values Putin's do you think he values Putin's opinion over his own intelligence operatives? I was like, so it's not just us here in America that are both flabbergasted and aghast over the events of the last couple of days. It's literally something that's being felt and heard all over the world. It is literally the cover of every single newspaper all across the globe. Donald Trump, Vladimir Putin, the implications of him saying that he believes Vladimir Putin over his own intelligence operatives. It's sort of a big, big deal. And, you know, a lot of people have lost their minds over that. There was this narrative that picked up for a little bit suggesting that what Donald Trump had done with Vladimir Putin constituted high treason. And people suggested that back in the day, the penalty for high treason was death, and therefore Donald Trump was in line to be executed literally any day now. It's a bit of a wackadoo fringe theory, but nevertheless, it's the sort of thing that has taken root in the last 48 or so hours. Basically, like I said, reiterating to all of us that we live in the year 2018 and things continue to be freaking nuts. But the question that I've been asked most consistently, the biggest piece of fallout from all of this, seems to be the query as to whether or not Vladimir Putin put a bug in President Trump's new World Cup soccer ball. It'd be very James Bond if he did. After the Helsinki summit between President Trump and Vladimir Putin, in case you missed it, Putin gave Trump a World Cup soccer ball as a gift. But what if it was actually a Trojan horse? Republican Senator Lindsey Graham tweeted, quote, if it were me, I'd check the soccer ball for listening devices and never allow it in the White House. And you know what? I mean, you kind of got to understand where this sentiment is coming from. Vladimir Putin's former KGB, he's known for some completely dastardly and Bond villain-esque tactics. And, you know, you'd probably imagine if I give Donald Trump a soccer ball, any sort of bug that's in it will be screened to oblivion. But he's worth a shot, comrade. So, yeah, man, if Putin really did that and it worked, I don't care if it's treason. You'd have to give him at least a polite golf clap. 10 out of 10 for style, minus several million for clear thinking. Anyways, there's video on my blog of Putin handing Trump the soccer ball. You can check it out online on any of the radio station websites that I'm on. Depending which station you listen to this radio show on, you can see it there. It's entertaining stuff, to say the least. Hey, you know what else is entertaining? A chance to talk to a rock legend. And that's exactly what we're going to be doing here today. We're going to, a little later on in the show, have a conversation with Art Alexakis from Everclear about what it's like to be 25 years into his career with his band and showing no signs of slowing down whatsoever. Thank you so much for hanging out. Thank you so much for joining me. If you want to weigh in, tweet me at ADSXE, or you can email me ad@iheartradio.com.
Radio 104.1.
Where the left and right come together for fundamental truths. AD on the radio, on Twitter at ADSXE.
So like you and I mentioned earlier, the great Art Alexakis of Everclear is going to be joining us on the show today. And essentially, we're just kind of sort of killing time until it's time to speak with Art. So bearing that in mind, while we've got a moment, let us just take a look at the events of today in our segment, My Witness News. What is going on in the world, I hear you ask? Well, a lot. So many things. For instance, happy birthday, first and foremost, to country singer Luke Bryan, who turns 42 today. Yeah, country singer Luke Bryan is 42 today. I'm not the biggest country music fan. Which one's he? I think he's the one who sings about hunting, fishing, drinking beer, and riding around on dirt roads in your pickup truck. Doesn't really narrow it down. Anyways, happy birthday. Black Sabbath bass player Geezer Butler is celebrating a birthday, too. 69. Yeah, Black Sabbath and sometime Ozzy Osbourne bass player Geezer Butler turned 69 years old today. I don't think he minds getting older, only because I think he said it finally makes sense that his name is Geezer. Ooh, this is a somewhat controversial move. Remember how Hulk Hogan dropped the N-bomb in that tape that Bubba the Love Sponge made of him? And when that happened, when that was made public, rather, he got kicked out of the Wrestling Hall of Fame. Here's the thing. Apparently, that doesn't matter anymore. Hulk Hogan was reinstated in the Wrestling Hall of Fame despite using the N-word. Now I would imagine that guy from Papa John's wants to take up wrestling. President Trump went on the record. We were talking about this in the show earlier. President Trump went on the record saying that he believes Vladimir Putin when he denies hacking our election. Yeah, President Trump has taken the word of Vladimir Putin over his own intelligence agencies when Vladimir Putin denied hacking our election. He believes him. Then again, you gotta bear in mind that this is Donald Trump. Donald Trump also believes that Melania did not marry him for his money. So there's that. Take it with the appropriate grain of salt. Paul Ryan has gone on the way. Well, oh man, this was a big deal. This was a big deal. The thing we talked about on the show the other day was the fact that there was bipartisan condemnation of Donald Trump's making nice with Vladimir Putin in the way that he did, saying that he denies it, I believe him. Paul Ryan was one of the many people to speak out against what Donald Trump said. He said that there is no question that Russia interfered in our election. Ryan is furious. He says it's almost as bad as interfering with his workout on leg day. Monica Lewinsky. Did you see this? Monica Lewinsky is in the news. Monica Lewinsky has gone on the record saying she has not had a full-time job since she left her White House internship in 1997. I think she's in her mid-40s now. And, well, ever since 1997, she hasn't been able to land a full-time job. I think she had a clothing line or a handbag line. And it's a weird thing. It's a very weird thing being Monica Lewinsky because she is one of the most famous people on the face of the planet. At the time in 1997, she might have been the most famous person on the planet. There was not a single human being scattered anywhere throughout all of creation that didn't have at least an idea of who Monica Lewinsky was and what it was she'd recently been through. So it didn't make her the most obviously employable person on the face of the planet, did it? No. I mean, a lot of people, I would imagine, would have thought, this is just going to be a never-ending distraction when she's here at work or for whatever reason. I don't know how hard she tried to get a full-time job, but she wasn't able to land one, and she hasn't had one since she left her White House internship. So she basically went through her entire adult life She stopped being an intern, I believe, in her 20s. And, well, now she's in her mid-40s, having never once held down a full-time job. A lot of people would tell you that that's surprising because you'd imagine a lot of male business owners would want to offer her a position on their staff. You can now get Crocs with 2-inch heels. Yeah, Crocs. You can get them with 2-inch heels. Perfect for the woman who wants to make a statement, as long as that statement is, I have totally given up on absolutely everything. The manager of a Chicago CVS. Did you see this? This is freaking disgraceful. I mean, look, this is without concept. This is without context. So we don't know exactly what went on. But if this is what it appears to be on the surface of things, it's absolutely freaking outrageous. The manager of a Chicago CVS called the cops over a black woman trying to use a coupon. Yeah, I'll just say that again. The manager of a Chicago CVS called the cops over a black woman trying to use a coupon. Really? What'd you plan to charge her with? Excessive thriftiness? Freaking ridiculous. Oh, man, this is definitely cause for some worry. Did you hear which lethal substance was stolen from a government vehicle? A government vehicle, no less, in Texas this past week just gone by? Yeah, cops are on the lookout like you wouldn't believe because in the wrong person's hands, this substance could be absolutely devastating. Somebody stole some plutonium from a government vehicle in Texas. Yeah, they stole some plutonium. Wow. Like I said, it's worrisome, worrisome stuff. I know it might seem obvious, but I wonder if the cops have checked with Marty and Doc Brown. Maybe they took it to power the flux capacitor. Ooh, did you see which superstar athlete has released a diet plan that a lot of people are saying they use to get in shape for the summer? If you've been out to the beach or the pool a lot this summer, you might notice that a lot of people appear to be in better shape than they were in recent years. A lot of people seem to have stuck to their fitness goals and actually achieved them. I'm not one of those people, by the way. I've resigned myself to yet another season of waddling and sweating. But a lot of people are in shape, better shape this year than they were last year. And a lot of people attribute it to this diet plan that a superstar athlete released. What was the diet plan? Who's the athlete? Tom Brady. Yeah, did you see this? Tom Brady of the New England Patriots released a line of meals based on his super strict diet. What exactly does it involve? Well, I think what the Tom Brady diet involves is a lot of lean protein and a lot of vegetables, you know, so you don't feel overinflated. Yeah, apparently Tom Brady doesn't like that. Did you hear which part of the female anatomy has doubled in size over the last 100 years? Yeah, one part of the average American woman's body is twice the size that it was 100 years ago. And that would be the American woman's shoe size. Yeah, American women's shoe sizes have more than doubled in size in the past century. So, yeah, just a footnote, ladies. If you're even a little bit self-conscious about your shoe size when it comes to accepting that shoe size, you need to toe the line or risk suffering the agony of defeat. Yeah. Okay, I'll shoe myself out. I'll show myself out. We talk to Art Alexakis of Everclear next.
For more stimulation and less irritation, 9 out of 10 doctors choose KPRC AM 950. Houston's more stimulating talk radio.
Don't get the blues, get all the news. We mean all of you guys out there in Radio Land.
All aboard!
He's back. AD on the radio.
Give it up, yeah. Give it up, yeah. Bring this on. Come on, come on.
We'll talk to Art Alexakis of Everclear in just a little bit. Right now, though, let's check out one of the songs that put him on the map at Santa Monica.
I am still living with your ghost, lonely and dreaming of the West Coast. I don't want to be your downtown. I don't want to be your stupid game. With my big black boots and an old suitcase, I do believe I'll find myself a new place. I don't want to be the bad guy. I don't want to do your sleepwalk dance anymore. I just want to see some palm trees. I will try to shake away this disease. We could live beside the ocean, leave the fire behind, swim out past the breaker, watch the world die. Leave the fire behind, swim out past the break.
doing good. How are you?
I'm really good. Thank you so much for making the time with us here today. I'm really excited to have you come through and play Kaboo September 14th. You're gonna be playing with everyone from Post Malone to Foo Fighters to Tower of Power, The Zombies, Gucci Mane, The English Beat. Out of those bands, is there anyone that you're looking forward to seeing, do you suppose?
Well, The English Beat. For sure.
I had a private bet with myself that it would be the English Beat. Go on. Tell me about you and the English Beat.
Well, man, you know, I grew up back in the day, and I remember getting their first record, the special first record. You know, I love that, the early, what would really be, people call it the first wave of ska. It's really the second wave of ska. But, you know, it was kind of the new wave, punky, more like, you know, late 70s, early 80s version of ska, and I love that stuff. I love punk rock. And you know what's funny is I still had long hair. I wouldn't cut my hair, but I was going out to punk rock shows. I didn't really listen to like old school hard rock much at the time, but I refused to cut my hair because it seemed not very punk to have to conform to a certain hairstyle. So I got into a lot of fights at rock shows. At punk rock shows, and I remember going to the English Beat and getting into a fight. I'm a little skinny guy, but I don't know. I used to like to mix it up a little bit.
Well, hopefully we can get you in and out of the English Beat show, Kaboo, without you mixing it up with anyone there.
It's one thing, a 22-year-old kid getting into a fight, a 56-year-old dad is not. That's just not a good look.
Well, I mean, sometimes you want to relive the full experience. You might be overcome and with a desire to punch someone in the face in the pit because that's just what you did last time you were at an English Beat show.
Yeah, true. They might start going into something and I might just start kicking someone in the teeth. But one of the things that's different is I haven't drank in 29 years. So
right.
I think that's going to have a lot to do with the whole decision-making process. You know what I mean? I think that's going to have a lot to do with it, for sure.
Yeah, I find people that fight tend to fight less when they don't drink.
Yeah, that's what I mean. When I quit drinking, I was becoming an ugly drunk, and there's nothing worse than an ugly drunk. It really isn't. Yeah. Some people get all happy when they drink, and that's good stuff. Me, not so much.
It speaks to your tenacity that you recognize that and did something about it.
Yeah, that's simple. Tenacity, that's my mom. My mom taught me tenacity and taught me to call myself on my own business, as it were. And, you know, it's just like I'm very thankful to her for many, many things, but those two things for sure just taught me to never give up. Just don't, you're not done yet. Go finish it.
Wow.
Do it right. Do it right the first time. Kind of tough love, you know. She was a scary old hillbilly that grew up in the Depression, and those people are just tough as nails.
Mm.
They don't play. Probably your grandparents grew up in the Depression, and they just do not play about anything. And I'm very thankful for my mom because, you know, I think a large part of my success is because of her. Mm. I didn't have a dad around, as everybody knows. And she filled those shoes very well and loved me from the moment I was born to the moment she died. Loved me fiercely.
Mm.
And that's all you can ask for in this world. Anyway, but I'm stoked about Kaboo. I'm stoked that they asked us to play and we're playing with all those bands. Of all the concerts that are going on, all those festivals, if I had to pick one, it would definitely be Kaboo. And I'm just really pleased that we get invited to play. It's going to be a blast.
Do you remember? That's awesome. No, it is going to be a blast. And your show is going to be a very big part of that. Do you remember? I mean, here you are, 25 plus years later, still playing and still, you know, I guess, you know, it goes back to what your mom said. You're not done yet. And you are not anywhere near being done yet. But do you remember, like, maybe the first time you played San Diego? Do you remember, like, coming back here when you were first starting out?
I absolutely do. Absolutely. The first time we played San Diego was we had Everclear had just finished our demo tape called World of Noise, and I put it in the mail to a bunch of people, and I paid $400 to make it, and it turned out to be our first record,
mm-hmm.
World of Noise, that came out on an indie label later. But I sent it out. We got accepted into South by Southwest, when they were still playing indie bands, you know, when it was still a good way for people to find out about you. But we figured we just like went just, you know, knuckles to the wall, and booked shows across, all the way across. And I got a show in San Diego at a little place that was like a coffee shop. And they were going to pay us $100 to play there, and they put us up, and they were just wonderful. And the next time coming through, we played a place that I'm sure you know of called the Casbah.
Sure, still there.
Not where it's at now. It's the first place when I was under the freeway.
Mm-hmm.
And, man, that I had 104 temperature playing that show, and I think we might have got signed from that show because I mean, I was so shaky and just, you know, fever, everything, and I just said, what the hell? I went out there and just kind of threw myself into it, and we had a great show.
Wow.
So I love San Diego. We played San Diego much during the day, but it was a big deal to play San Diego for sure.
Very cool. Well, we're going to be so stoked to have you back. Do you remember, like, if you had to pick one, maybe it was a show that you saw, maybe one record that you listened to, a television appearance maybe, but if you had to pick one moment that made you go, this is it. Music is something I have to do. Music is a must for me. Would you be able to pinpoint what that could be?
Yeah. I was 4 years old and watching the Ed Sullivan Show. I think it was the last time. It was 1966 that the Beatles played on Ed Sullivan. And I remember, and then the next weekend, I was on fire. And my brother, that was about the time my brother was 13 or 14, got an electric guitar and an amp and brought it home and started playing in the garage. And I'm like, whatever that is, that's what I want to do. And it never changed. That's always what I wanted to do, is play guitar in a rock and roll band. It's never changed. It's pathetic and sad, but sometimes that single-mindedness is what gets us to where we want to be. It was just like, you know, well, you got to have something to fall back on. Nope. That's what I want to do.
You know,
oh, you could go to college, you got great SATs. Nope. I want to play in a rock band. I want to play in a rock band, chase girls, and at the time do drugs. Now, it's not sex, drugs, and rock and roll anymore. You come to the Summerland Tour, which is, we put on every year, 90s alternative band. We're all a bunch of middle-aged guys, so it's sex with your wife, food, and rock and roll.
There you go.
That's kind of how we roll these days.
That I owe you, yes, you can pay the bills. I will give you more when I get paid again. I hate those people who love to tell you money is the root of all the kills. They have never been poor, they have never had the joy of a welfare Christmas.
Yeah. garden where your flowers can bloom. I will buy you a new car, perfect shiny new. I will buy you that big house way up in the West Hills. I will buy you a new life. Oh yeah. I will buy you a garden where your flowers can bloom. I will buy you.
More AD on the radio.
Father of mine, tell me where have you been? You know I just closed my eyes. My whole world disappeared. Father of mine, take me back to the day. Yeah, when I was still your golden boy, back before you went away. I remember blue skies walking the block. I loved it when you held me high. I loved to hear you talk. You would take me to the movie. You would take me to the beach. Take me to a place inside that is so hard to reach. Father of mine, tell me where did you go? Yeah, you had the world inside your hand, but you did not seem to know. Father of mine, tell me what do you see when you look back? You wasted life and you don't see me. I was 10 years old, doing all that I could. Was it easy for me to be a scared white boy in a black neighborhood? Sometimes you would send me a birthday card with a $5 bill. Yeah, I never understood you then, and I guess I never will. Daddy gave me a name.
It's interesting that you started this chat talking about your mom only because something you said sort of reminded me a little bit of Dave Grohl's mom actually wrote a book about what it was like to be the parent of a rock star. And in doing so, she talked to a bunch of different rock star moms. And the common denominator seemed to be that at some point, usually between the ages of, I think it was like 10 and 14, it became clear that your kid was not going to be doing anything else with their life. They're like, and it sounds very similar to what you might have had happen to you. You were younger. You were four when you saw the Beatles on Ed Sullivan. But with your mom being the type of person that drilled you with that tough love, and you know, you do it right and you finish your job. Once you made that clear to someone like her, how'd she take you wanting to do music?
You know, she just, like, she's like, it's a hard road. Millions of kids want to do that. No one does it, son. It's not going to happen. Just get a safe job. But, you know, she would say things like that, and then she would spend her last $50 and buy me a guitar for $40 and an amp for $10 out of a pawn shop. You know, she would tell me conflicting things deep in her heart. My mom always wanted to be an actress, and she had a chance back in the 40s. She was offered a scholarship and a place to live and everything to go to the Pasadena Playhouse, which at the time was a conservatory. And it's funny that I ended up living in Pasadena, because we never did when I was a kid, but I live here now. And her dad wouldn't let her go. And I think she always had this dream of doing something creative and expressing herself, but she never got a chance to. She started having kids and had to work, and you know, she always had her nose to the grindstone. But I think deep down inside, while trying to impart those basic working class values, she loved the fact that I dreamed big. Mm. And I remember in 96 when we were having our platinum party for our Sparkle and Fade, I made the label, you know, they rented out this big restaurant down in Venice. There was paparazzi and red carpet. And my mom, you know, I picked my mom up at the airport in a limo. And she's like, what's all this about? And then we get there, and there's just people going crazy everywhere and taking pictures and stuff. And she's like, boy, is this for you? I go, yeah, mama. I sold 1 million records for like, on magazine covers and stuff like that. We're number one on the radio. And, yeah, that's for me. She's like, she goes, damn. She goes, I never thought it would happen, but I'm so glad it did. And it was great because of the success I had, I was able to take care of my mom for the last part of her life, you know? And, that was a big deal, but her just finally realizing that this whole band thing really actually kind of worked out, you know, and she came to my house. I bought a big house in Portland. She's like, so are you running this? How much is this a month? I go, no, mom, I own it. I own like three houses. No, it's cool. She just couldn't fathom it. And yeah, I think anyway, I never read that book by Dick Grohl's mom. I heard about it. But I think that there's one of the things I've noticed about people who've been successful, not just in music, but in anything in their life that they have passion for, is just this tenacity and single-mindedness and just put the blinders on, and that's what I want. You're pointing to the future. That's what I want. How am I going to do that? I'm going to do it this way. Oh, that didn't work. Let's try this. You know what I mean? Mm. You get your butt kicked in life. It happens to everyone. You're not defined by that. You're defined by how you pick yourself up and what you do afterwards. And that's something my mom taught me as well.
Leave the stimulation to the professionals.
Everyone is so smart.
KBRC, more stimulating talk radio.
There's something happening here, and you should know what it is.
The dumbing up of America.
Now, more AD on the radio.
Radio,
this, I think you know it's true. Situations where it's easy to look down on you. Think you like to be the victim. Think you like to be in pain. I think you make yourself a victim almost every single day. You do what you do. You say what you say. You try to be everything to everyone. You know all the right people. You play all the right games. You always try to be everything to everyone. Yeah, you do it again. You always do it again. You say they taught you how to read and write. Yeah, they taught you how to count. I say they taught you how to buy and sell your own body by the pound. I think you like to be their simple toy. I think you love to play the clown. I think you were blind to the fact that the hand you hold is the hand that holds you down. You do what you do. Yeah, you say what you say. You always try to be everything to everyone. You know all the right people. You play all the right games. You always try to be everything to everyone. Spin around and fall down. Do it again. Yeah, you stumble and you fall. Yeah, why won't you ever learn? You ever learn? Come on, do that stupid dance.
Talk about my mom so much, huh?
Well, you know, I mean, obviously she's really important to you, and you know, these are excellent life lessons. And you know what, honestly, I get a chance to talk to a guy like you who has accomplished so much and who has continued to accomplish so much over the years, and I want to know how that happened and if it had to do with your mom. I mean, look, if there's something that's going to create accountability for you, your mom spending her last $50 on a guitar and an amp so you can go make music, that'll do it.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, she was always supportive in that way. You know, she was never really warm and fuzzy, but she told me she loved me every day of my life that I saw her. Every day.
Wow.
Not one time. I could be 40 years old, and she'd be, you know, sitting in my guest room. She would come in and tell me that she loved me a good night. Every night. And I think if you have that in your life somewhere, you're going to be okay. Especially if you can appreciate it. You know what I mean?
All I know is after this call, my next one's going to be to my mom. This is
yes.
This is some heavy. This is some heavy stuff, man. Thank you for being willing to share. It is a beautiful thing. Someone that tells you they love you every time they see you. There's no substitute for that. That's amazing.
Yeah. I do it to my daughter every day. Every day.
You
anyway.
No. Yeah. You built things, however you got there, you built things that really have lasted. So many bands, they're here today, they're gone later today, but you have songs that have stuck around for, you know, a lifetime. And now you've got this tour that's stuck around for, look, tours come and go pretty quickly too. But you know, Summerland is in its sixth year. You built stuff that lasts. Like if your job was making chairs or furniture, I would want an Alexakis because, you know, I knew it was going to stick around.
No, we're having dinner at the Alexakis tonight.
Yeah.
we're pulling out all the stops.
Why?
You know why? Because I grew up with the classics, and I was so fortunate to grow up in a time where, and in a family where everybody loved music. Not necessarily the most musical family, but we listened to music constantly. My mom, country music. My dad, Sinatra, crooners. My elder sister, like Motown. My brother, totally hard rock, acid rock, stuff like that. My middle sister, the acoustic singer-songwriters. My younger sister, pop radio. So I grew up with all of it. And I learned that there's really only two types of music, the music that you love and the music that you don't. And, you know, that's what it all comes down to. And I love so many different types of music that I think it helped give more depth and breadth to the music I make. And the people I work with are of like mind. We all come from a long history of loving songs, not just music, but songs, rock and roll songs, pop songs, country songs, just a story, a universe in 3 minutes. You know, that's what I grew up loving.
Yeah. There's certain guys like you, and like maybe Rollins or, you know, maybe Eddie Vedder or someone like that, who remain fans, even though they've, you know, sold millions of records and, you know, been on the cover of every single magazine. Like I remember, can't remember where I read it about you, but I think even at the time that you were experiencing success for the first time or starting Everclear, weren't you still a member of like the Sub Pop Singles of a Month Club or something like that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Until I stopped doing it. Yeah. For years. Yeah. And, you know, I mean, I have a radio show on SiriusXM. As a matter of fact, we just got done doing it for this week. And basically it's me and Freddie, my bass player, who's about the same age, grew up in California, a lot of the same similar background. And we just love music so much. And basically what my show is, two dudes just, it's like going over your friend's house and he's that music freak. Hey man, you got to check out this single. Dude, you got to hear this album. This band, I saw this band, they played 20 minutes opening up for Kansas, and I hate Kansas, but I love this band. This is a band called Cheap Trick. Check these guys out.
Uh-huh.
You know, I had experiences like that. And then when my friend would leave the room, I'd take his tape and leave and go home and listen to it. And then I'd see him at school and go, give me back my tape, Art.
Dude, that's the whole reason I got into radio. As a kid, I like nothing more than finding music that I liked and playing them to my friends. There was a boombox in my homeroom, and whenever I found something I liked, I would put it on the boombox and just wait and see if anyone in the room reacted, being like, and if they got it, I was like, yes, they get it. And if they didn't, I was like, are you deaf? Are you stupid? What's going on? But yeah, that sharing of music is, by the way, Freddie is an old buddy of mine. You know, know him from the
XCs.
Yeah,
the XCs had a hell of a history there. Sure.
Yeah. And then, I was in a band for a while, and we played shows with them here and there, but Freddie's one of the good guys. He's a real dude. He is an OG. Sure. And,
I've been trying to steal him. I was trying to steal him back in the day. You know, I mean, I wanted, and he's too good of a guy to leave his band. But, we were friends for years and years and years. And then I had to let a bass player go. Second bass player or third bass player of Everclear, and I just hung up the phone from the guy. I was walking to the bathroom. I left the phone on the bed, and then it started ringing again. I thought that was that guy calling back to, you know, say something nasty or something. And I'm like, ah, I should let it just go to voicemail. And I'm like, no, I'll go pick it up. And I pick it up, and it's Freddie. And I'm like, hey, Freddie. He's like, hey, man, just want to let you know that the XC spoke up. You know anybody needs a bass player? I'm like, oh, yeah, you got a job. He goes, who? I go, don't be stupid. No, me. And that was, you know, almost 10 years ago. And so, yeah, he's one of the good ones for sure. But don't tell him I said that. He's right here. I don't want him to think I'm... I don't want to have to pay more money than that.
Right. Well, you know, if it's like the rest of my broadcast career, no one's ever going to hear this anyway, so we'll be fine. No, actually, I was the I haven't been for a while, but I used to be the morning guy on Alt Nation, and I worked on Octane and Faction on Sirius XM. But I was the voice of Lithium, that station you're on, for a little bit as well. So
really,
yeah, I was really? The guy. If there was ever like the autobiography of, you know, Nirvana to be read when they were getting into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame or whoever, I was the guy that got sent like the copy the night before, like, read all of this, we need it soon. Like, that was me.
Oh, okay.
But
your voice sounds really familiar, but I figured it was just because we probably talked over the years.
Well, there's that too. There's that as well. I think they still use some of my stuff on there.
I gotta jump to this other call, dude. I've had so much fun talking to you. I could talk all afternoon.
Oh yeah, this has been an absolute blast. Well, do your thing. Thank you so much. We cannot wait to see you September 14th. You're gonna be at Kaboo playing with everyone, like I said, from Post Malone to Foo Fighters to Tower of Power, and we'll see you in the pit during English Beat. Hopefully not getting into fisticuffs.
Yeah, hopefully not hitting anybody. If you could help me out there, that'd be great. If someone gives me a hard time, if you could take the punch for me, I'd appreciate that.
I'll be your muscle if Freddie's not around.
Yeah, well, Freddie will be there right next to me. You better believe that.
All right, man.
Dude.
I'll see you soon.
Good to talk to you, man.
Take care, dude. Thanks
Bye-bye.
So much.
When it gets too sad, I think thoughts that I know are bad. Close my eyes and I count to 10. Hope it's over when I open them. I want the things that I had before.